The interwar years delivered arguably the most interesting aircraft and piston engine development in history. It is often referred to as the Golden Age of Flight. While piston engines for aircraft peaked during World War II, most of that is a result of the wild engine development that happened during the interwar years. While there are various ways to increase a piston engine's horsepower, to drastically increase horsepower at the time, more cylinders were needed. This led to a lot of interesting engine layouts with 18 or more cylinders, one of which was the X engine. Only about a handful of different X layout aero engine designs ever got built, most of which never got past the prototype stage, and none are generally considered to have been successful. That is arguable, so let's look at two X engines with different levels of promise and success. The Packard X-2775 and the Rolls-Royce Vulture, and you can judge its success for yourself. During the 1920s, air races were the proving grounds for military fighter aircraft concepts, the most popular being the Schneider Trophy Air Race, often erroneously called the Schneider Cup. Mario De Bernardi had just won the 1926 trophy in a Mach-E M39, powered by a Fiat AS2 V12 engine producing 801 horsepower, setting an average speed of 246.49 miles per hour when a group of enthusiasts announced they will build a plane and participate in the next race in 1927, with US Navy pilot Al Williams to pilot it. This was a private venture since the US government declared it wouldn't officially send a team to compete. But indirect support from the US Navy would be offered, which was to cover the cost of engine development. American engine company Packard was asked to design and build an engine, and the airplane would be built by Kirkham Products Corporation and was to be called the Kirkham-Williams Racer. Since there was limited time to develop the new engine for the 1927 race, Packard looked at what engines they already had and homed in on their 1A-1500 500 horsepower V12 that they designed in 1924. Even though it had a reputation for being unreliable, Packard decided to use as many components from their V12 as possible to create the new design called the 1A-2775, with military designation being X-2775. Since a quick way of massively increasing engine horsepower was to double the amount of cylinders, they did just that by virtually stacking an upright 1A-1500 V12 atop an inverted one connected to a common crankshaft to create an X configuration engine. The angle between the top two cylinder banks and the bottom two banks of inline sixes remained 60 degrees as it was in the 1A-1500 V12. This meant the bank angle between the top and bottom banks on the sides of the X engine was 120 degrees. 24 individual steel cylinders were mounted to a single piece cast aluminium crankcase to keep weight as low as possible while giving maximum strength. The engine was liquid-cooled, and cylinders each had four valves, two inlet and two exhaust, and were operated by a single overhead camshaft per cylinder bank. In an attempt to improve exhaust valve cooling, the valves had hollow stems to allow cooling by oil. The valve covers of the bottom cylinders also acted as a sump for oil collection. The ignition system was battery-powered and had four distributors at the rear of the engine. The crankshaft had six crank pins, phased 120 degrees apart, like found in an inline 6 as well as a V12. Assuming the build adhered to the design drawings, the crank pins didn't have the standard inline 6 crank throws with the usual mirroring of two inline 3s, where the center two crank pins were at the same position, same as the middle and outer crank pins. In my opinion, this would be a strange design decision, which I don't quite understand as it discards the perfect balance of the inline 6. This engine consisting of four of those. This would likely have resulted in a slight imbalance in the form of a rocking couple. The whole point of using six inline cylinders for each bank instead of seven or five is because of the inherent perfect balance of the inline six. But when changing the crank throws, that perfect balance goes out the window. Each of the six crank pins moved four pistons, which were all aligned and conrods moving through the same plane of rotation like on a radial engine. Meaning, like a radial engine, it necessitated the use of a connecting rod assembly made up of a master rod and articulated rods. All conrods couldn't be articulated, since this would allow the rod assembly a certain degree of freedom to rotate around the crankpin bearing, which then affects the position of the pistons in the cylinders. This would be problematic and would quickly lead to catastrophic failure. To prevent this, one of the conrods needed to be fixed to the rod assembly to prevent rotation around the crankpin. The other conrods were articulated. The articulated conrods were shorter in length than the master conrod, and the reason for this is the position of the big end of the articulated rods. Unlike the master conrod, which rotates around the center of the crankshaft, the articulated rods each rotate around a point slightly offset of the center of the crankshaft, which was positioned towards its cylinder. This not only results in an elliptical rotation rather than a perfectly circular rotation like the master rod, but it would also result in the piston moving higher up in the cylinder towards top dead center, and thus the articulated rods need to be shorter. But we have not yet gotten to the weirdest part of this engine. The engine's crankshaft was not placed in the center of the crankcase, but around 38 millimeters above center. To accommodate this, the two lower articulated rods had to be 38 millimeters longer than the top articulated rod, meaning of the four conrods of each row of cylinders, only two were identical. This also meant that for each row, the four cylinders did not have the same displacement. The cylinder with the master conrod had a stroke of 127 millimeters, and the cylinders with articulated conrods had a longer stroke of 130 millimeters, which was due to the elliptical motion of the big end and the shorter length of the articulated rods. Cylinder bore was obviously identical at 136.5 millimeters. The cylinders utilizing a master conrod had a displacement of 1.86 liters, and the cylinders with articulated rods had a displacement of 1.91 liters, and so the total displacement of the engine was 45.5 liters. Despite the seemingly crazy engine design, the engine worked and even passed acceptance testing. At 2,700 RPM, the direct drive engine produced 1,250 horsepower at a weight of 686 kilograms and gave the Kirkham-Williams racer a good max speed of around 270 miles per hour. However, early indications were that the competitors in the 1927 Schneider Trophy race would be faster than that. In response to that information, an attempt was made to make the Kirkham-Williams racer faster before the race. So a second X2775 engine was built, this time with a Roots-type supercharger. However, due to time constraints, it was hastily assembled and the supercharger created less than 4 psi of boost and increased engine power output to only 1,300 horsepower, at a penalty of making the engine about 100 kilograms heavier. This was disappointing, and instead, the designers thought that the additional weight of the supercharger could be better spent being replaced by a propeller speed reduction unit, geared to a 0.67:1 ratio. By slowing down propeller speed, propeller blade efficiency could be increased. However, with the engine and overall plane development still ongoing by the time of the air race, the Kirkham-Williams racer did not compete in the 1927 Schneider Trophy race. The race was won by the Supermarine S5 at an average speed of 281.66 miles per hour, more than 10 miles per hour faster than the Kirkham-Williams racer could do. The X2775 was further improved by increasing compression ratio, by replacing the battery ignition system with magnetos, and by installing a ram air induction system. This upgraded engine was installed in a new racer called the Williams Mercury Racer, with Al planning to use it to compete in the 1929 race. Although looking like a monoplane version of the Kirkham-Williams Racer, the Williams Mercury Racer was a completely new design, and right from the start had issues with being overweight, mostly unrelated to the engine, and the seaplane was unable to take off. Some work was done to the aircraft and seemingly to the engine as well, but the weight issues couldn't be resolved to a satisfactory degree and the plane could not compete in the 1929 race. Further attempts were made to improve the plane, but problems persisted, and with support from the US Navy faltering, it never got close to competing in a race before the Schneider Trophy races ended in 1931. The engine was further developed in the mid-30s into the 2A-2775, and some sources claim the engine produced an impressive 1,900 horsepower at 2,800 RPM. Despite the problems with the Williams Mercury Racer, the X-2775 engine itself didn't have any major problems and was quite reliable. However, with the US, especially the Navy, investing heavily into radial engines around this time, the Packard X-2775 engine faded into history. Surprisingly, the X-2775 wasn't to be the last of the X-configuration aero engines. Around the mid-30s, the British Air Ministry anticipated that a 2,000-plus horsepower engine would be required by the early 40s. Rolls-Royce, who was quite specialist with V12 engine design by this time, decided to try their hand at the X-24 engine to meet this 2,000-horsepower requirement. The X-24 in theory should have been able to roughly double the power of their best V12 at the time, which was the Peregrine, the ultimate version of the Kestrel. Fast forward a few years, the Rolls-Royce Vulture ended up as the only X-24 aero engine to have entered large-scale production in history. Like the X-2775 before it, the Vulture design started out as two V12s sharing a common crankshaft. Rolls-Royce initially used the inline cylinder banks of the Peregrine, but as the engine developed, fewer Peregrine parts were used and eventually it shared no parts with their V12. Unlike the X-2775 from Packard, the 60-degree V-bank angle was not retained, and the angle between all four cylinder banks was 90 degrees. A six-throw crankshaft was installed in the center of a two-piece crankcase and was supported by seven main bearings. Each cylinder had four valves, two intake and two exhaust, with the exhaust valves being sodium-filled to improve cooling. The valves were driven by a single overhead camshaft on each six-cylinder bank. The 127mm bore and 140mm stroke gave the Vulture a displacement of 42 liters, and the liquid-cooled engine's dry weight was 1,111 kilograms. Propeller speed was reduced by a 0.35 to 1 reduction ratio compound gear reduction unit. With its two-speed single-stage supercharger, early indications showed that the engine should produce around 1,750 horsepower at 3,200 RPM. Like Packard's X-24 before it, the Vulture used a master and articulated conrod setup. And here is where much of the Vulture's trouble manifested. The engine first ran in 1937, but had problems with main bearings due to cooling problems, lubrication problems, or both. Even so, many hundreds of hours of testing had been done on the engines, and Rolls-Royce was confident the problems could be resolved. I couldn't find any official record of the Vulture's firing interval. It seems to be a slightly debated topic on forums, with some saying a cylinder was fired every 30 degrees of crankshaft rotation. Others are saying no, two cylinders were fired at the same time, meaning it was fired in intervals of 60 degrees of crankshaft rotation. Others saying it was 90, 30, 90, 30, and so on. The only official reference I could find was in regards to firing order. Cylinders were numbered by a row, starting with number 1 on the propeller end to 6 towards the rear. And the banks were numbered A to D, starting top left, going clockwise. Assuming this sequence is correct, firing interval must have been in 30 degree intervals and eliminates any other possibility. If it was fired in 60 degree intervals or 90-30-90-30, then it would need to fire two cylinders at the same time, since 60 times 24, the amount of cylinders, is 1440, which is 2 4-stroke revolutions. Same for 90-30-90-30. And if two cylinders were fired at the same time, then the way the firing order is written makes no sense. To test this, I created a 2D simulation to see if the firing orders work out with 30 degree intervals, and it does. That meant the Vulture had an even firing interval after all. I also checked to see if it could fire two cylinders at the same time with this firing order, and it cannot, as every second piston is not in the correct position to be fired when the first one is. The simulation does not allow two cylinders to be fired at the same time with the stated firing order. This assumes my cylinder numbering is correct. Anyway, I spent a few hours trying to figure this out, and it will take me about 10 minutes just to explain what I did here, and I'm not going to do that. Feel free to replay my simulation and work it out if it's important to you. If you do find a different result than I did, leave a comment below. For the rest, let's carry on. By 1938, the Vulture successfully produced the targeted 1,750 horsepower, and in 1939, engine production was given the green light. But the aforementioned reliability problems meant the engine had to be derated by limiting max RPM to 3,000. To avoid power loss at the lowered max RPM, supercharger boost was increased from 6 psi to 9 psi. The Vulture was set to power the twin-engined Avro-Manchester bomber, which first took flight powered by two Vultures in 1939. Several hundred Vultures were then ordered for Manchester production. The Vulture was also set to power a new fighter aircraft, the Hawker Tornado, which too first flew in 1939. Testing went quite well, and again several hundred Vultures were ordered for Tornado production. An updated prototype powered by the Vulture 5 achieved an impressive 398 miles per hour at 23,000 feet. Tornado production was delayed during the Battle of Britain, with Hawker understandably prioritizing Hurricane production, which was crucial for the defense of the nation. To make matters worse, Vulture development also had to be halted to allow Rolls-Royce to focus on the Merlin engine, which of course powered the pivotal Hurricanes and Spitfires. This halt in development meant that the Vulture later went into production with many of the reliability issues still present. This contributed greatly to the problems on the Avro-Manchester bomber. With a very high engine failure rate, and the bomber which in most circumstances were unable to maintain altitude on one engine after the other failed, led to the demise of a high number of Manchester crews. Because of this, the bomber was grounded several times. Engine failures were attributed to cooling issues and main bearing failure, also caused by cooling and lubrication issues, among a few other problems. Max engine RPM was again lowered, this time to 2850 RPM, in an attempt to lower engine failure rate. After many modifications, eventually engine reliability improved drastically. However, it seemed to be too little too late. By this time, the Merlin was approaching horsepower numbers not far off the Vulture, and Rolls-Royce decided to focus on Merlin and Griffin development and production and cancel Vulture production. The Vulture-powered Tornado fighter, which surprisingly didn't experience engine issues to the same degree as the Manchester bomber, was cancelled shortly after Rolls-Royce stopped Vulture production, and Hawker instead focused on the Napier Sabre power derivative called the Typhoon. The Manchester bomber was subsequently redesigned by replacing the two Vultures with four trusty Merlins and became the Lancaster, a very successful bomber in World War II. Was the Rolls-Royce Vulture a failure then? In my opinion, yes, but I think it would likely have been successful if development continued. There also doesn't seem to be any inherent problems with the X layout, but ill-timed events that caused development disruptions, as well as other 2,000 plus horsepower engine layouts that were more advanced at this stage, like the Napier Sabre, the Rolls-Royce Griffin and Bristol Centaurus, pretty much made the Vulture redundant. And of course, with the advent of the turbojet engine, which made all high-power piston aero engines redundant, there was no reason to later find out if the X layout could have been successful, or perhaps even superior to other layouts. I hope that was informative and perhaps even enjoyable. If it was, then you will probably like these two videos as well. Thanks for watching. See you in the next one.